Welcome to Night Shadows. I'm Stewart Best, where the paranormal is normal, where that which you thought you knew, you didn't, and where the future can be known if you know exactly where to look.
Where do you want to start? There's so much news out there.
Oh, my. It's just incredible. I tell you what, you kind of got a feel for what's going on. You just kind of lead me where you want me to go, and we'll just talk about what you got kind of highlighted.
Well, why don't we start with Planet X? Because Marshall Masters just released quite a detailed article. And, you know, there's so much disinformation, misinformation out there about this approaching body. I mean, we know it's coming because the Bible says it's coming. The Book of Colburn says it's coming. And we're getting all these pictures now on the Internet. You want to kind of get into that Marshall Masters thing a little bit?
Well, it's really interesting. You know, actually, I was reading his article, and Marshall follows very closely the Planet X theory and the destroyer. You know, he knows about the Colburn and also, interestingly, on January the 20th, 2016, Caltech researcher released a paper in an astronomical journal, and it was entitled "Evidence for a Distant Giant Planet in the Solar System." Now, that really sounds strange. What's the even stranger is the timing of this. Recently, a Brazil observatory apparently had taken some photographs that appeared to be legitimate, according to Marshall Masters, and I think Augusto Perez had some information on it, and there were some images that got out and could not be blocked. The powers that be tried to block this, but some of it still got on the Internet, and, you know, once anything's on the Internet, it usually doesn't disappear. So they have to kind of
viral.
Yeah, they cover it up. And so this is what's interesting. Recently, you know, there's been a big push the last week or so about something called Planet Nine, which is really weird, you know, because basically they really don't have the evidence. In other words, the evidence they say they have for this Planet Nine, which is they appear to have found another planet at the, you know, outer edge of our solar system. But they can't see it, and so what they're saying is that there's some other planets and moons that are being affected by it, and they're saying it's there because of that effect. Now, that's strange because, you know, before this, all of the data, basically, that had been coming out about the destroyer or whatever, there was reports, and, you know, they got debunked every time you turned around. And so Marshall Masters did some digging and some research, and this is what's interesting. In 1959, a science fiction film that was written and directed by someone by the name of Edward D. Wood Jr., which Marshall says is a pseudonym name. In other words, it's a supposed name for somebody else, but he actually did a film. And it was a really interesting film. It was called Plan 9, the number 9, from outer space. And supposedly, you know, you've seen the article and you've seen the picture of the movie, the poster. It's actually something so, you know, what it portrays is there's something so terrible out there in outer space that will affect Earth that we can't even talk about it. It's so terrible and it's coming and blah, 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 you know, and it's a real scary thing. And in 1959, and Bela Lugosi, you know, starred in it, here you have this scenario. Now, this is what's interesting. Marshall Masters says that those that have tried to bring this Planet Nine scenario in, and they're using the nine, N-I-N-E, you know, instead of the nine as far as the number.
Which
is what he calls, he says they're using an acronym. And this is what's interesting. This is what he says, and he says based on fact, he says Planet Nine, N-I-N-E, and I'll read the words that nine appears to represent to those that are illuminated, so to speak, now. Nibiru, is near extinction. In other words, N for Nibiru, I for is, N for ear, near, and E for extinction, and that spells nine, N-I-N-E, which is what they're calling this planet nine. See?
Well, that would go along then with ELE and Deep Impact.
The movie, absolutely. I mean, there you go. I mean, we've been, Hollywood really has been, and you and I have discussed this really often and in depth over the years that these movies came out. We continue to say that they're warning us. They're really telling us in our face what is coming, yet they act like it's fiction, but it's not. It's warning. It's real. They're telling us everything they're doing and everything to expect. We just don't have, and I'll put it this way, Stewart. I'll use a Donald Trump term that he borrowed from you, that mankind is so stupid, I'm using that stupid term, that we can get, because you and I used that before, and then we found out actually stupid's biblical. You know?
Yes, it is. I guess people can wonder about the Hollywood connection, but what was that movie that came out about a star? Remember, they saw this star coming that had a solar system, and they built a spaceship to jump over to the planet of the inbound sun. What was the name of that?
And
that was back in the same period of time. That was back
that was
in
cool
the 50s.
Black and white movies, and I think I had that movie somewhere. I'll think of it. I hadn't thought of that in a while, actually.
But you know what's interesting to me is also the fact that Zachariah Sitchin, which I don't think he's he has a very, how do I say, unbiblical view of things, but he was talking about the 10th planet. Well, if you take Pluto out of the picture as a planet, then you don't have a 10th planet coming in. We just have a 9th planet. So it seems like this thing has been in the works for a long, long time. And I know the Book of the Colburn says that the wise know where the destroyer went, and they also know when it's coming back. Now, Gordon Michael Scallion, who did an Earth Changes newsletter, I'm not sure if he still does or not, but he made the comment that the government people know all about all of this, but they're not going to tell anybody because there's no point in it. I mean, how are they going to, they were afraid of an economic collapse. In other words, and I would say the rich men and the government are, if you know, for example, that in a week or a month you're surely going to perish, what would you do? You're certainly not going to obey anybody's laws. You're just going to do whatever you feel like doing, unfortunately. And I think that's one thing they're afraid of, is that it would cause an economic collapse, number one, and nobody would pay any attention to martial law or anything like that.
Well, Stan Deo often said over and over about, coming earthquake catastrophes and asteroid impacts. And he even mentioned in a lot of the movies, he said they're conditioning people for something that's coming. And he said they will never, ever tell the people. They'll never warn the people because people would immediately all turn inward and they'd all just do their own thing. And you remember that you remember the movie Knowing. Remember it?
Oh, absolutely. There was another one.
You remember the very minute that actually came, they started warning people on television, the day that they began to warn about it publicly, it went into total chaos. Everything went into complete chaos.
Yes.
And so Stan Deo says that's why that they'll never really warn what's really coming down. It'll be a surprise. It'll be suddenly. Isn't it interesting, Stuart, the Bible in Ecclesiastes talks about the same things happening over and over and over, except on the human side of things, because of manipulation, we always have these sudden events where there didn't seem to be any symptoms.
Yes. Yeah, that's true. And, of course, the rich men are a funny breed. Number one, we can say they've got an evil intent. I mean, they're definitely going to call the herd, the human herd, or they're going to try. And I guess we could get into the reasons for that. But they do announce what they're doing. It's really not a secret conspiracy. It's an open conspiracy. They've not only announced it in their publications, like the protocols, which everybody says is fake, Iron Mountain, that was a fake, Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars, that's a fake. They're all fakes, and yet everything that's in there is coming to pass.
Absolutely.
Which is also very interesting to me, that if it's a fake, how is it that everything in there is being accomplished? Like Iron Mountain, for sure, is definitely, they're just doing it. It's kind of in your face doing it.
Oh, we're seeing
it. Go ahead.
We're seeing exactly what you're talking about every day. And even recently on the rock face of that thing that talks about what's coming down. What do you call it?
I'm not sure what you mean.
I believe it's in Georgia Guidestone.
Oh, the Guidestones. Yes.
Recently,
in writing.
Yeah, and not only in writing, and people don't believe it. They recently added a date on that thing.
I saw that.
I can't remember what it is, but all this stuff really is in people's face, yet they just won't believe it.
I think Obama could probably come out on TV and said, I'm suspending the Constitution and I'm stealing all your money, and everybody would clap. something's going wrong. I don't know what it is, but it's, this destroyer thing, if they can't really announce that, and they do have to kind of poo-poo it. But what do they do when people look up in the skies and they see this thing? Then what?
Well, I think that's the part about, I can't remember if it was a Coleman, but something talked about there being a frightening. I can't remember if that's a prophecy or what, but a frightening. And I think that's exactly what we're going to see. People will be frightened and pretty much everything will be over as far as chaos.
Yeah, I know the Book of the Colburn says that the noise of it even drives people crazy. And I believe that the destroyer is actually found in Revelation chapter 12. It's the great red dragon. I think what people don't understand is that there's a spiritual side to it, Satan being represented. But then there's an astronomical, not astrological, but an astronomical side to it. And that would be the approach of the destroyer. And it's also in Isaiah. I think Jeremiah even alludes to it, because he says something happens and it goes all around the planet and towns and villages and all that are just simply destroyed. If you had an approach, you remember the vision that Red Elk had, where he said it looked like, at first he thought it was the moon. And it came by Earth, and it impacted the atmosphere, kind of bounced off the atmosphere, and went into the sun. And I know Ed Dames, Mr. Doom, Dr. Doom, he said almost the same thing, that a large space body came very close to Earth and then kind of careened into the sun. And that was to cause, I believe I'm doing this right or remembering right, that was the thing that caused the kill shot routine, where you had multiple
right.
CMEs.
Yeah, Ed Dames and Red Elk basically saw something come close into our, as a matter of fact, to glance off the atmosphere of the planet, I think, and go into the sun, and then That's one of the series of CMEs from this, I suppose, this cosmic event began to come. And you know, I think Red Elk and Ed Dane both was kind of seeing the same thing, really, but just from a different angle.
Yes. Well, it's kind of interesting, too, that you've got all this, you know, you've got the Hopi prophecies of the blue star, Katrina, whatever they call it. And, you know, there's a fellow by the name of Dr. LaViolette that wrote a book, Earth Under Fire. And again, basically what he was attempting to tell people was that, look, this mythology of the ancients is not mythology. We're misreading what they were warning about. And they only told us in the language they knew, which, of course, now we classify all of that as mythological old wives' tale, and there's nothing to it. But even the Lord said, you know, there's coming an end to the age, and we're in a transition period between one age going out and a new one coming in. And I don't know, all the prophecies seem to me to be being fulfilled very rapidly, not only here on Earth, but in the cosmos out there.
Oh, it does. It really does. And you know, when you just, you know, I know a lot of times we tell people, don't believe everything everybody wrote and think they were all right. I mean,
right.
You know, I know a
yeah.
lot of people try to place fulfillment of Scripture, you know, ahead of what's really going on out. You know, when you just stick your head out the window and watch, you can see a lot that's happening. And a lot of it is fulfilling Scripture. And maybe it's not fulfilling it exactly like everybody said it would be fulfilled, but it's being things are happening. And you're so right on, we are really we're in a very strange time it's what I'll call an overlap. Almost one age overlaps over another one, and for a little time there during this overlap, it's really a lot of confusion because you've got one outgoing age, and at the same time, you've got an incoming age, a different one, where things
yes.
are organized differently, and it's very confusing.
Well, it's sort of like when the Lord was crucified, and you had the veil in the temple rent, and then it took a transition time. People, I guess, argue over when that occurred, when he was crucified, around 30, 33 A.D. probably. But it was not until A.D. 70 when Titus came in and destroyed Jerusalem, basically, and, you know, the diaspora began. So that was a transition period. And it's very, very difficult, I suppose, for the people living during that transition period to figure out what's really happening and why it's happening. But we have the beauty of hindsight now, and we have the beauty of science if we can get some of these. Well, a lot of the people that talk about this Planet X seem to be, how do we say, vanished? Would that be a play term?
That's very true. It reminds me a little bit of the microbiologists that have vanished. Certain people are vanishing.
Well, that's another subject in and of itself. We could drift off there for a minute. How many microbiologists? I know Steve Quayle's been kind of monitoring all that. What are we up to, 40 or 50
of these people? It's in that range. Yeah, I think it's in the 40s, but that's so many. I mean, that's absolutely so many. And you know, it's just like Harrington, you know, who began to warn about something out, you know, outside the solar system that was coming in. And, you know, I think his first name was Robert. I don't remember exactly.
Yes.
You know, something happened to him. And then it's just been a number of people since then that have been having problems and disappearing or dying by very strange manners. And we've seen this ongoing for some time.
It's Harrington was the one, if I recall, that actually built an observatory down in, I think it was southern New Zealand, wasn't it? So that he could track that. And of course, now we've got an infrared telescope, big array, down there in Antarctica. So, and then I read that they sent the probes out specifically to see if they could find this incoming object. And, of course, if you relate the inbound thing to the Earth changes that are going on, if you relate it to very odd moves of the feds moving a lot of their stuff into Denver, the massive undertakings of underground cities and tunnels that go for literally thousands of miles underground. A lot of people don't even believe that, but we're getting videos now from truckers who go down there. And I heard about that when I was out in Denver. I went out there to do, I think it was a seminar or whatever, but we got a ride with a cabbie at the new Denver airport.
Mm-hmm.
And we're riding in the back, and he says, "I bet you don't know what's underneath you." And I had an idea, but I said, "What?" And he says, "There's a huge underground city. We're going right over it right now." He says, "It's huge." And I said, "Well, how do you know that?" "Oh," he says, "I've been down there many, many times, taking people down there and picking people up."
Wow.
And I said, "Well, I thought this was all supposed to be secret." And he said, "Who's going to believe a cabbie?"
That's true.
And I thought that's the perfect answer. So why would these people be spending literally trillions of dollars, black budgets, unless they're afraid of something coming? And we know all the nations of the world are doing it.
Oh, yeah. So we even heard, and recently, this is what's really odd, the Palestinians, they are having an underground center built. And we know that Israel has done the same thing. All the other countries, seem to be placing their safe locations underground. And, of course, this is above our pay grade, Stewart, I guess. It never filtered down to me.
Well, we get
right.
to look at it. We get to watch it coming inbound. They evidently want to hide down there. But, I would not want to be underground, actually. I think the earthquakes, the water weight of huge tsunamis that are going to be done because of this thing, you cannot, when I think it's in where Jesus said the sea and the waves are roaring.
Mm-hmm.
Well, why would that be occurring unless you have huge gravitational waves causing that to happen? And if you have go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to mention what you're describing. If you'll remember, in the movie 2012, they actually... and a lot of that was actually real science. I mean, the part about these neutrinos or whatever, neutrinos that are going inside the Earth and exciting the interior of the Earth and causing it to expand, and that brings on all this polar shift and all this other stuff. That's real science. I mean, Standale was kind of on the cutting edge of a lot of that, and he's the one that's been talking about a lot of the so-called sinkholes as stretch marks on the surface of the Earth, because the Earth is moving. It's in a position of flux. And in 2012, what I was going to say was that was so interesting, because they didn't really do a lot of digging underground because of Earth movement. They actually built those what appeared to be spaceships, and then they figured out they were great ships to survive on the ocean, on top of the water,
It makes you wonder if they aren't doing that same thing. There are a number of, I've seen some photos that people, they go on Google Earth and they must spend hours looking for strange stuff. But there are some very strange, anomalous things that are appearing here and there. And it makes you wonder if the rich aren't doing a number of things in their attempt to escape what's coming. I know Alternative 3, a lot of people poo-pooed that and said, that's just garbage. But I did a documentary on Alternative 3, and that's not garbage. That's real stuff.
Right.
And
right.
We can prove that there are buildings on the dark side of the moon, We can prove that there are structures on Mars that are, in fact, when we did Project Red Star, you were having, and I didn't tell anybody what I was doing when I did Project Red Star.
Oh, you didn't even tell me.
I didn't tell you. I didn't tell anybody, and that was on Tithonia City, and you were having these visions about Mars. Do you want to get into that a little bit? That was because I think that ties directly into Alternative 3.
That was really interesting because of the fact that, you know, I had no idea you had the image, you know, JPL or a NASA image of Mars, and the location of that, what you termed as Tithonia City. I had no idea you was doing all that research, but yet I began to have these experiences to where I was seeing. I'll use Red Elk's term. I love his term for looking outside the body, so to speak. He called it seeing, and it's very,
yes,
very true, because there's a Greek word eido, E-I-D-O. It describes a perception that sometimes it's really more than just looking. It's a perception outside the body that entails many, many things.
Yes,
and,
yes.
And
look
so
upon.
Seeing is a good word. And I was seeing and experiencing situations and locations on Mars, even tunnels and buildings, and I had no idea that you had the real data, real-time data, and was researching that and doing work on it. And I would call you after one of these, and I had about 8 experiences actually in a row, and I would call you and I'd tell you about something I saw in the tunnel. I'd tell you about the outside of the mountain ranges and the buildings, and I would tell you about, you know, the different things that I experienced, and you would, you know, say that was really interesting, but you didn't tell me that you was really real time looking at the same data, you know. And you know, I've told you about saucer craft on Mars that I saw, and you actually had them in an image from NASA.
Yes, yeah, they're sitting right there. There were 2 of them sitting on,
yeah,
a ramp. And they're just, to me, they're as plain as day. But, you know, that brings us into another movie. What was the name of that? It was made over in Europe, and it was about the Nazis building a base on the moon, and then they tried to invade. It was a kind of a comedy or a parody.
Iron Sky.
Iron Sky.
Iron Skies. That's it.
Well, if you take that to Mars, they could be building a fleet. You know, Carol Rosen was Von Braun's spokesperson for about 4 years, I think. He was dying of cancer. And so she would speak on his behalf. And he kept saying that the alien card was going to be the last card that the military-industrial complex was going to play on humanity. We have to defend outer space because of an alien invasion. And then he would turn and he would say, "Now, Carol, remember what I told you. The last card is the alien card. And it's all a lie." It's all a lie. So that was very, very interesting because he's the one who told Gordon Cooper, you know, our astronaut, that Germany, just before the close of the war, had developed anti-gravity saucers, and they were using them.
Yeah, which goes along, you know, we incorporated that with Operation Paperclip. Now, you know, of course, they keep it secret, but we have a space fleet, which nobody talks about. Except those in the know, they're whistleblowers, but they get threatened for talking about it.
Well, who was the guy over there in England that tapped? I love guys like that. He tapped into some military Pentagon website. They're trying to get him. They're trying to get extradition, but England so far has said, "No, sorry, you can't have him." But he was the one, kind of like Snowden, and
right.
He said that he found a whole stuff on the Pentagon site, about off-Earth crew members.
Uh-huh.
Off-Earth crew members for what?
That's right.
Well, then you jump over to Steve Quayle, and he's been talking about the TR-3B fleets for I don't know how long, him and Hawk. And I know that even Stan Deo, he worked with Dr. Teller on
Yeah, Antigram. Stan Deo, you know, he worked actually with a lot of, you know, the, I guess you would call it the anti-gravity. A lot of the anti-gravity workability of craft and stuff. You know, he did a lot of work in that. He said that was big, and they were far ahead of what people thought, you know, at all. And
Go ahead.
I was just going to mention Barry Rothman. He has looked into a lot of this, and on his website, artcode.com. Matter of fact, I sent you a QR code.
Yeah. Life on Mars?
Yeah, this is a brand new one. It's called Martian Life, and it's from NASA Images, and it's January 2016 data, and he ran a QR code on Martian life, and he came up with the terms Mars life and sphere again, and he says Mars life was connected to one of the spheres. And then and if you clicked on that link I sent you, it would take you right to some images of the spheres that the QR code is talking about, and somebody else was telling him is actually some type of life form on Mars. Now, I know people think this is really getting way beyond, but one of the things Barry Rothman, he's a rabbi, one that has studied a lot of Martian. Matter of fact, he and his son does a lot of speakings on Mars, and he's battled with JPL and NASA on a lot of the studies that have been done on Mars as far as the colors that the Martian atmosphere has. The air atmosphere. And he actually, they have bowed to Barry Rothman and said, you're right, and our data was not that accurate. And so there's a lot about Mars we don't know.
Well, they're lying about the color. If you really take the color and you adjust it to what you know, this is what NASA doesn't understand, I guess, when they produce all this kind of stuff. There are people out there who know how to adjust the color back to the way it's supposed to be based on maybe something on the rover, and they know what color it actually is. So then they adjust it back. You got a blue sky. There's a lot of weird stuff going on, and who knows exactly, you know, a lot of this is public. It's for the public. It's like Iron Mountain's empire building, and it's kind of an alternative money stream. You know, people will fund the space program like they fund the military, and they're kind of alternative money streams to keep the taxpayers, you know, pumping the money out of the taxpayer because, you know, we gotta fight this. We got all these enemies, blah, 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 and we've got to have this program and that program. But what's kind of interesting is that when you really view the real color of what Mars is, it's a blue sky. And
right.
So, you know, it makes you wonder, and they say the moon is not quite the way we're being presented either, so I don't know, you know.
Yeah, there's more and more data coming out about the moon. Matter of fact, I posted a picture the other day that someone did a Google moon and found it appeared to be a metallic building with connections and raised walls around it, and it just simply something like that is not natural. It's more artificial.
Well, one of the guys was called in. You're familiar with Stephen Greer, not?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Well, he's running that disclosure project, and he's got all these witnesses that have stepped forward. One of the guys that came forward, interestingly enough, was evidently a tech on photography equipment and whatnot, and he got called into one of the bases down there on the East Coast to fix something. And while he was in there assessing what the problem was, he said the guy that was doing the photography work showed him pictures of, on the dark side of the moon, these big, big structures. He said they were huge. Yeah. Now, he didn't say who built them, whether they were somebody else's or ours, but he said they were there and clear as a bell. And he also said something very interesting. He said, when I went into this base, this building, he said there were people from every country milling around.
Mm.
So, you know, this is not something, and I agree with you, the general public thinks it is so far out, they just simply cannot open up their heart or open up their minds enough to understand the real technology that we have, whether it was channeled or what. Now, the German technology they claim was channeled, you know, which would be occult stuff, demonic stuff. But, hey, the fallen angels, they knew all about this stuff. With the Book of Enoch, it's pretty clear that they gave mankind a lot of secret knowledge.
That's true.
So,
well, you know, they had the knowledge of really, you know, if you look at some of the extra books, especially, and Enoch will talk about it clearly, you know, a lot of the what we call function of our universe or our solar system or even our own planet, you know, whether it's the winds, daylight and dark, or all this other stuff, is I guess you could say managed or maintained by angelic hosts, you know, angelic
yes.
beings. And if you look at it like that, some of the fallen angels probably had taken with them some of the way our material universe is created and maintained, and so they could give secrets away to man. And I think they've been doing it a long, long time.
Yeah, well, you know, you only have to ask, I think, one question. Where did the Mayans get such accurate calendars? How did the Mayans know that there was a black hole in the center of the Milky Way, which we just discovered, what, maybe 10, 15 years ago? A massive black hole in the center of the Milky Way. Well, how did they know that? Who told them
that? That is very true.
So, you know, you have to wonder, and then you have to wonder, well, who built all the pyramids around the world? Why are they located on ley energy lines? It all is going to tie back to Genesis, I think. I think this all goes back to Genesis and the golden age of the gods, so to speak, the fallen ones.
Well, that's very true. You know, I'll mention something that people don't even believe. Jonathan Gray was a researcher on it and got the data on it, you know, and I'm talking about what we call the magic mirror. You remember me talking about that one time?
Yes, I do.
I sent you a report on that. Yeah, and I had an email last year. I checked back with Jonathan Gray after we did a talk on that or a discussion on one of your programs or maybe a couple of your programs a few years ago, and this magic mirror basically was something that was dug up in a coal mine about 2 miles down or so in Russia, and it was brought to the United States, and it was taken to a black project site, and they began to try to work with it. When they opened the box, it was something that looked shiny, like a mirror of some sort. And what's so interesting, you know, is the fact that, you know, when it started turning on and working, though, was when somebody in another building was working with some frequencies and sound turned it on. And that's what really clues me so much on this movie, you know, from Ridley Scott, Prometheus. You know, I know you've probably seen that.
Yep.
They actually started their spacecraft with a tone, like a flute-like tone, you know, turned it on. And I thought, wow, wonder where they got that. But anyway, this frequency penetrated the other building where they had this, what I call the magic mirror, and it began to actually scroll words. You know, it was a language. Now, it wasn't English, of course. It wasn't Russian.
And when they began to find out it was ancient Hebrew, an ancient Hebrew language that was scrolling across the screen, and then a little later they found actually it withheld images, in other words, like photographs inside it. And, you know, it reminds me now so much of one of these iPhones, Stewart. You know what I'm talking
yes.
about?
Yes,
it reminds me the day of an iPhone, but it was dug up in a coal mine embedded in coal, and it had people wearing clothes and had purses and wearing jackets and hats in these images. But, you know, they don't talk about it. But in France, I've done some research. There's some deep caves in France that there's ancient drawings with people wearing clothes, and they won't even let people know about that. That really, we didn't come from a bunch of cavemen, Neanderthals, that had a rock in one hand and an old stick of wood in the other. I mean, we really, you know, there was a technology in the past before the flood that was really, I mean, people were flying. That's where they come out with these in India manuscripts
yeah.
about the Brahmanas and things like that. You know, people, but if people don't ever look, don't ever research, don't ever read, don't ever think, they'll never know there was anything. So I really believe the magic mirror probably was really, and matter of fact, it was identified as one of the saints, you know, before the flood, as the owner, actually. They identified it, gave a name. And
well,
so,
you know, it's kind of fascinating, too, what they found, because if I recall that correctly, weren't there some comments that, they were losing, that Adam, number one, was an idiot, basically, at that point in
uh-huh.
time. They thought he was kind of an idiot. But they were losing their powers. And so
that's
they
right.
had resorted to technology to make up what they couldn't do anymore.
Yeah, that was very interesting. You know, Adam was basically what, I guess you could say an Oklahoma term, an old fogey. In other words, he believed... He believed in the old ways of doing things, and the way, of course, we know that Adam was, you know, he was made at a level, even probably spiritually, pure spiritual level, but even technologically, you know, there was powers or abilities within him that mankind basically don't have today. And
Exactly.
And there was also some references that they were talking about. There was a glow to the people in the early days of Adam, that the people began to lose. And with the losing of that glow, they also lost the abilities of, you know, different things like travel. You know, I think they mentioned travel, you know, like we would talk about
teleportation.
Teleportation. Yeah,
yep.
They had some abilities to do things like that. And then they began to lose that over time, and they began to go towards technology, and that became the big thing. And matter of fact, this is what's interesting, Stewart, on that image, one of the images or the photos in that magic mirror when they got it working, it showed they had cars too, or vehicles, ways of transportation. And it wasn't a woolly mammoth. It was a technological vehicle of some kind, you know.
Well, you know, what was will be again.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says that. There's nothing new under the sun. Nothing. People had TVs. They had airplanes. And people are going to say, well, what happened to all of it? Well, if you have a pole shift and whole continents get turned over and buried deep in the center of the earth. And by the way, they found, if I recall this was maybe a couple of years ago, didn't they find a piece of a continent way down that hadn't quite melted yet?
Yeah, Stuart, you're exactly right. They found where the earth had literally folded over a part of a continent. I believe it's in the Atlantic Ocean, and it was pristine, way below the ocean there, great depth, and down under the earth. They somehow had found that it had folded it under in some kind of episode, you know, a previous episode of time, and it was preserved. And so, you know, a lot of the things on top of the planet, you know, of course, you know, we had the flood,
yes.
and a lot of things changed after that. And then, you know, there was waters in different areas. You know, before the flood, it didn't even rain. So things changed.
It. Yes, Mr. I don't think people understand that either, because before the flood, the atmosphere was much thicker. It had much more oxygen in it, and it never rained. Like you said, it just missed it in the evening. It was the coolness of the evening, and all the ground was watered by the mist, or dew,
that was,
I guess is what you'd actually call it.
Yeah, and that was what was so interesting about Noah, was the fact that he was told it was going to rain, and he said, "Hello, what was that word?"
What?
You know, that was a new thing, and I'll spring forward here, Stewart. You know, now the scripture tells us about a coming fire, and you know what? I wonder, it could be the sun that causes it. I don't know, because you know the last one was a cosmological event that caused the destruction. Maybe that brought the rain, not only rain, it actually brought the waters from beneath the earth up through the earth, too. And so maybe the sun, you know, I wonder if the fire that's coming is sun-related. It may be.
It is. There's a Bible code about that, and it goes along kind of with the kill shot. But there's a code somebody found about the sun, and it's going to roast mankind. And if you look up, you remember when the Lord said that if the days had not been shortened, nobody would survive, not even the elect.
No flesh saved. Yeah.
Well, if you go into the book of Revelation, you've got your 1260, 1290, 1335, which is kind of interesting. People argue about all that. But the point is, the days are actually numbered. Now, if the days are numbered and yet the days are shortened, he can't be talking about shortening the number of days. He's got to be talking about shortening the days by the hour.
Oh, the time of darkness.
Yes, and he says by one-third. Well, it takes 24 hours for the world to turn around, right? Well, what's one-third? 8. So we go from a 24-hour day to a 16-hour day. Now,
is the Earth going to spin faster?
It spins faster. Now, I don't know this is going to work, but now relate the spinning of the Earth faster to a much hotter sun, either because the orbit has been moved closer or the sun many novas. Well, if you got a 16-hour day and a hotter sun, it's still going to be plenty warm, but mankind would actually survive because it would have only an 8-hour day and an 8-hour night.
That's right.
Now, you and I can't even begin to fathom such a massive change, but I don't think people can fathom a crustal pole shift either. I got into that when I was on the Art Bell Show. What happens when you have a pole shift? I mean, the oceans leave their beds. The atmosphere begins to roll up like a cloud because it can't keep up with the Earth. And on and on. And the massive volcanic activity, the massive earthquake activity. I mean, you know, you just probably, unless you were right by the pivot area, you probably wouldn't survive.
That's right.
And that gets you to the pyramids. They claim the pyramids are actually at the center. So it makes you wonder if the last little shift, because remember, is it the book of Jasher, which I'm not asking people to believe it, but isn't it in the book of Jasher where it said that Noah saw that the earth became inclined?
I think so. Jasher, Jubilees, it may be Jasher.
So, if the Earth became inclined, that would be a partial pole shift.
It would. That mean it would lean. Well, you know, even, you know, you and I over the last few years even have been watching locations of where the sun rises and goes down, and that's been changing off and on. So there's been a wobble. That's exactly what it is.
And I even took some pictures, because we had people calling us and saying, particularly women, they would say, well, Well, for this time of year, the sun shouldn't be shining in this room. It's never shone in that room before.
Mm.
That sort of thing. So I went out and got pictures, and it, for the most part, it appears very normal, but every once in a while, you just see it off. It's off.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you had a vision about that. The white, was that a white buffalo?
Oh, that, yeah, the white buffalo vision. That's been a number of years now. Matter of fact, that's one that Red Elk said that he really believed, you know, when I shared it with him. And that was
well, it would mean something. Yeah, it would mean something to Red Elk.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And everything meant something to him. The white buffalo, the heights of the white buffalo to me, because he said that showed a time frame. And it was a partial. I saw a partial pole shift. It wasn't a full pole shift. It was only a partial one. And it was a warning. And Red Elk said, yes, that there was going to be, he said there would be a partial one first and later a bigger one.
Wow. The first one is a warning to everybody.
Yeah.
So that brings us back to the destroyer, which would probably be the instrument the Lord would use to do it.
Certainly could be.
So when we have such an increase in comets hitting the sun, asteroids impacting the Earth, all this strange stuff going on, and the sun acting very anomalous, we can tie that right back to the approach of the destroyer and its little bridal party of Nibiru, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, I guess, can't we?
That's very true. That's very true. And one of the interesting things is, you know, I had an experience where I was taken out past the sun and shown the destroyer. You know, when this first came up, we started talking about it.
I remember that.
And the interesting thing is, though, it was far on the other side of our own sun because, when I actually took that trip, so to speak, I was taken, I saw the planets. I understood which planets they were because of Saturn with its rings, and you could tell Mars and Jupiter, you know, because I knew what they looked like already. And we went past the sun and way out there, and I was shown the destroyer really, really up close. Now, I didn't see the entourage because I was just, it was like being next to a huge flower in a way. It was dark, but it was like a flower almost. And like I said, it looked like it absorbed light almost. It didn't, you know, really give any light, yet it had heat. You could see there was a heat within it, but it didn't give light. It was darkened.
So that's a brown dwarf.
Yeah, it was a brown dwarf. I've come to that conclusion that it was a brown dwarf star, probably the other sun, because they clearly tell us today, finally, that we're in a binary
system, yes.
Binary
which is normal.
Star system. Yeah, which is normal. And, of course, nobody ever asked where the other sun was. If binary means two. That's the way I was taught. And so that means there's another one. But the other one is a really strange one, a rogue one, that didn't fully ignite, and it's a brown dwarf star. And this is what's interesting. Even in, some of the there was a recent movie that came out, a sci-fi, it was called Impact. That's the name of it, Impact. And a portion of a brown dwarf star impacts the moon, and a part of that breaks off and impacts the Earth, and then they start drawing together and pulling the Earth towards the moon, or vice versa. And it's really interesting because that's the first time I've really heard them in movies talking about a brown dwarf star and something with so much gravity. You know, it's compact so much that it's incredible. But anyway, when I did see it, though, I saw it really, really up close, and it was really, really big. And when you're up close to it, you can see it. But
okay, so now can we relate this to this announcement? Going back to the announcement of the ninth planet, didn't they say that was about five or six times the size of the Earth?
Oh, yeah. They said it was big. Interestingly, too, if you saw the artist rendition they did with it, it's blue.
And I was talking to Augusto today that was studying some of that, and he said it's interesting. He thinks the blue might be Nibiru, and it's what the Indians or the Native Americans or the ancients called the blue Kachina. And mm-hmm. the red one, he thinks, really is the destroyer itself, the brown dwarf star. That's what they've called the red Kachina over the years.
Yes, I think he's right. And it's really, really amazing that, you know, we're, well, they can't hide this stuff forever. I mean, they can try and murder everybody that comes out, but sooner or later, you know, it's kind of like Barb Lazar in Element 115. I was watching a video the other day on YouTube, and they were mentioning, it was the new X-Files.
Oh, yeah, I haven't seen that, but I know what you're talking about.
Well, they're releasing everything. They took Mulder and Scully in a hangar. They had anti-gravity craft. They had cloaking, all that. They were talking about Element 115. Well, Bob Lazar broke that 30 years ago.
I remember that on Art Bell years ago. He was talking about it.
Yeah. Yeah, that was what they were using.
And, of course, at that time when he was talking about it, that element, Stewart, he was a great big liar, wasn't he?
Well, they still call him a liar, but everything he's said so far has come true, so I'm going to opt that he's telling the truth. Yet, like he said in a recent interview, he said, I wished I'd never even talked about it.
Yeah.
That's what he said. He said it was just, I was young and foolish, and I thought the world should know about it, but they didn't want to believe it.
It reminds me a little bit, Stewart, of you when you began to work with Tithonia City, and you that was Project what, Red Star?
Yes.
And you remember you was on Art Bell, but later on you had Lear, John Lear, try to help
yes.
you. And really, Art Bell confirmed to him everything you were saying, but they couldn't touch it. They couldn't touch it at all, and then everybody, you know, it became what, you know, I'm not proud of the term, but a non-event, you know.
Well, you know, it was funny about that. After we released it, of course, nobody wanted it, and it was like you told me when we were going to release it, and I finally told you, you said it's going to be, the Lord told you it's going to be a non-event. But what was fascinating is this non-event, one of the people that got it took it to NASA. And I don't know who they talked to at NASA, but the comment basically was this. You're not supposed, where did you get this? You're not supposed to know anything about it.
I believe you.
so you can't win no matter what you do. People are, you know, they're trapped in their normal life, daily life. And for whatever reason, they do not believe the comment that the truth is usually stranger or always stranger than fiction.
That's right.
And I think that's where we're basically at with this thing. I want to talk to you about also, you know, the approach of the destroyer and the earth changes that are now accelerating. Oklahoma still seems to be the earthquake capital of the world.
Oh, my. We're having, absolutely. Yeah, they recently have said that, of the whole planet, that right now Oklahoma is more active on a daily basis than anywhere on the planet. Now, I know that's strange and that people would say, oh, that can't be. But, you know, I watch them every day, and we're having almost up to four in magnitude, and mm-hmm. these are going on. In other words, twos and threes are nothing anymore. We're up to fours and reaching towards fives. And this is all day long, every single day for months. And, of course, there's no explanation. They're saying fracking causes it, and they do frack in Oklahoma. But, you know, I've talked to some people that's involved in fracking, and they tell me, or those that supposedly know what they're doing, say that you can have small earth movements with fracking, but it won't be over a 2 magnitude. Whenever you have one, it won't be over a 2, and your depth will be shallow. You're not going to have real deep depths. Now, you know, a lot of these are 3s and 4s and larger, and the depths on them are almost like 9 to 10 miles deep. this is too deep for fracking quakes. This is something bigger. Of course, you know, we're kind of like the incident in California with the methane release.
Let's get into that. What's going on with that?
Oh, my. Did I send you some data on that?
You might have.
I was thinking I did.
But I know, what's his, can't think of his name right now, but you've talked to him, you've interviewed him. He lives there.
Yeah, Richard Shaw. Richard Shaw.
Yeah, yes, yes. What's
Richard
his
Shaw.
Habits?
Go ahead.
You know, what's he telling about this? He lives there, so.
Oh, it's amazing. He lives in Porter Ranch, which is he's within about 2 miles of his house is where this massive gas blowout occurred. And this is what's interesting. He said the more we're looking into it, the more we're researching, the more we're finding the dirty little secrets. What they thought originally was a few wells, you know, methane wells up there, and they've been digging them for years, he said. A lot of them are really, really old. And it's a big project. And, of course, what a lot of people don't know, too, that there's radioactivity involved. They don't know that there used to be radioactivity there where these wells are. But there was. And they had a blowout. It's kind of, he said, he likens it actually to the BP blowout in the Gulf of Mexico. You know, you remember that one.
Oh, huge. Huge.
Yeah, and this is huge. And I was looking at some of his research, and at one time it was the blowout of methane in this canyon, which is right there at Porter Ranch, basically. It was releasing 50 tons or more of methane per hour, 24 hours a day. I mean, massive, massive amounts. And there's other things mixed with the methane, and they're really concerned because of, you know, like I said, there are some radioactivity involved in that. These are very deep wells, and what he has found out by researching is that these wells do not have cutoffs. How about that? You can't turn them off.
Mm-hmm.
And so, well,
so how many wells
these
are involved? Many, many, many.
Well, they originally, you know, were thinking that it was just a number of wells that were involved, but that, you know, they didn't know that there was over 200 wells there.
Ooh.
And it's massive. And, you know, they're telling the people in that area that probably that all these people need to leave. I mean, everybody needs to leave. And, you know, people are moving out. They've moved out around him all over the place. You know, everyone's hunting somewhere else to go. As a matter of fact, they even warn them, don't even go out and do one jog a week out in this, you know, the atmosphere of this. And so it's like you can't do anything but hide in your home from the atmosphere when this is going on. One of the things that they're really concerned about is, you know, methane is very explosive. So
that could just blow, be a massive explosion.
It'd be a massive explosion, but what if, and I'm just saying a what if, I'm not, you know, predicting anything at all, of course. I'm just saying what if the explosion also went on down the wells below ground?
Well,
it would be catastrophic.
Well, that would
absolutely catastrophic.
That would probably fracture all kinds of plate tectonics, and you'd have massive earthquakes.
Yeah, we're talking about on the edge of Los Angeles. It's not like there's not a lot of people around. I mean,
yeah. Wow. So I suppose they're kind of worried about an explosion. But why isn't this on major media? They're not even mentioning it that I know of.
Well, one of the things that they didn't even declare it an emergency for a while was they finally found out that Jerry Brown, the governor, is really in deep with the people that's involved in this and their production of methane and the gas there. And so there's been a delay. And, of course, they've already got a class action lawsuit by everybody involved, but the danger is still there. It's still ongoing. Everybody's pets are dead or gone. Even the fish have all died in the ponds, and everything's, you know, there's no, you don't see anything moving as far as animal life. It's all gone. And isn't it odd, though, Stewart? I watch Fox and CNN. MSNBC. Sometimes I'll click on there. And, you know, I'm not hearing this. Are you hearing this?
Nope. No, they're not mentioning it.
And it simply hadn't went away. It didn't. It hadn't vanished. You know, it's. But this is one thing that they're keeping really, really quiet. And problematic also probably is, you know, they're having some big earthquakes, especially off the coast of California right now. Some of those, you know, the fault line areas are moving. And so this could connect in with the, you know, but instead of oil, you know, they were drawing out methane from underground, you know, caverns that are full of methane. And it's massive.
Well, you remember the big holes that appeared, I think it was, what, it was in the Russian area, Siberia?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's a new one, too. Have you seen that new one in the Himalayas?
No.
Oh, my, no. It's huge. It's huge. As a matter of fact, they say that they're not too sure that it's not one of the openings, you know, that you remember Standeo said that there's some openings in the Earth that go deep inside the planet.
Yes, remember that.
That is... Yeah, and they're not even sure this may not be. This is a massive thing. I've seen a photograph, a satellite photograph of it, and it's big. And it does really resemble the holes that we've seen in Siberia that showed up. But the ones in Siberia are like mini holes compared to this one. I mean, they're small.
Well,
I don't know whether they're blowouts. I don't know whether it's a blowout. People thought at one time maybe something had, you know, meteorites had hit. But it looks more like they're blowout holes. Something has blown out.
Well, that's what some of the scientists said. They thought they were methane blowholes. That it just all of a sudden there was such a massive release that it just blew everything out. But in the Himalayas,
what's interesting, Stewart, is you know, Standeo for a number of years has warned about what is, you know, I go back and I hate to go back to movies, but if you go back to 2012, the movie 2012, and you watch it really early. On in the first of the movie, they go deep underground in these mines, deep underground, and they find the activity of what the sun is doing to the interior of the planet and causing the planet to swell or expand.
Expand, yes.
That's what's going. That is what's going on, according to Standeo, for a number of years now, but nobody's been talking about it. And it's not only causing the volcano movement, the magma movement, the earthquakes, but also, I believe it's displacing this these big pockets underground of methane and blowing them out. I may be wrong. I'm not a scientist, so I can't, and I'm not a geologist, so I can't say that. But I wonder.
Well, you remember on the East Coast, 2, maybe 3, 4 years ago, that they had these strange smells that suddenly came out of the earth, and they couldn't figure out.
Yeah, it smelled like rotten eggs, or it was a terrible smell, whatever it was.
And I think that's exactly what's going on. The Earth is expanding, hence we have these rifts that are forming all over. We have these huge sinkholes. In fact, I read today that there's a big one in Oregon.
Yeah, there is. There's more than one, I think. I've seen some recent ones. They're having a lot of this activity happen in Oregon, but also Florida is just being pocketed with these things. These sinkholes are everywhere in Florida, it seems like, opening up.
That's probably a clue to maybe get out of there, but, you know, I guess a lot of them aren't detectives, so they don't know how to put together one and two, you know, and figure out, well, maybe I should move. But it's just fascinating to me that all of this stuff is developing now, all of it indicative of an expanding planet. And if you go back, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be again. I think there's evidence that the Earth expanded rapidly during the days of Noah, particularly in the days of Peleg.
That's right, Peleg. That's a real clue.
You know, because that's when the continents evidently formed.
That's right. Well, they actually, I think that they actually began to separate at that point in time when he was alive.
Yes. So as it was, now it's happening again. So,
over again.
You know, it's like, have you seen, Steve Quayle's got a couple of pictures up on the website of these pterodactyls.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if you've seen that one, a kind of an old picture where they shot one down.
Where the old cowboys are there, look like cowboys.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the Earth, they claim, was smaller back then by quite a bit. So, therefore, the gravity would be less. The atmosphere was thicker. So that would give rise to the giants. That would give the Book of Enoch and the giants, the literal giants. And I interviewed, I don't know if you remember, but I interviewed Klaus Dohna.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, he's dug up some of these things.
That's true.
And Steve Quayle's got an excellent book out there on the giants. If people don't believe it's real, it certainly is. And there were giants in the earth in those days. So, again, you know, if you can't expand your mind and you can't expand your heart, I guess it's worthless anyway. Before we go any further, though, how do people get a hold of you and your newsletter? You really do a lot of work putting that newsletter out. And it's really fascinating, all the news flashes you put out to keep people up to date. How do they get on to that? How do they find that?
Well, the easiest way is to really just write in your internet or go to LarryWTaylor.org. That's LarryWTaylor.org. And anytime, 24 hours a day, you click onto that link. Just write it in your browser or put it in your computer and just go there every day. And you can read the news flashes, the radio flashes. You can keep up to date with what's happening. I do a lot of I do blogs. I try to do a blog a day or one every 2 or 3 days because it takes a lot of time. It's a time consumption. And I do that, but I also, as you said, put out news flashes. In other words, if there's breaking news or things that I think people need to read, I'll put out news flashes. And the easiest way to find it is just go to that location, go to that link daily or multiple times a day, check it and see what's there. That's the easiest way to keep up with me, actually.
Okay. And if they want to donate, how do they do that?
Or you would just have to, I sometimes have the address on there, but they can also, they can email me if they feel like they want to help me out or donate. Just email me at every single news flash and blog that I write at the bottom has a email address on there. And they can just use that email address and make contact with me. I'll send them an address if that's what they want to do.
Oh, super, super. What do you make of this Oregon situation? We got a big sinkhole out there that just developed, but kind of what happened out there? We're getting conflicting stories with the standoff. Do you have any of the latest on that at all?
I think there's still some standoff, maybe. There were some more of them arrested from the federal property there, what the feds call their property.
Right.
Yeah, it's actually just some old buildings that firefighters stay at when they come up in that region to fight forest fires is really all they are. But a big deal became when they began, there were some ranchers, and, you know, they set some fires to stop. You know, if people hadn't lived in that kind of country before where there's lots of dry brush and lots of fires, you know, sometimes you have to set fires to stop fires.
Right.
And they pled guilty and went to prison for setting the fires, and then the feds came back and said, well, now since you served your prison term, you have to go to federal prison and serve a mandatory number of years for that. Well, that stirred up a lot of the people that believe that government needs to stay out of people's business. So these guys already had pled guilty, went to prison, and came, you know, had come back. And
right.
It seems like, though, that and you know what I'm talking about when I'm talking about, you know, the federal, you know, the EPA and all of them, BLM, you know, you just can start naming all of them that really took over America. It's kind of like Mike Huckabee said. He said, I can't believe anybody would think that you just give all the land to the government and let the government or trust the government to dole it out. That'd be good for everybody. And so anyway, the government's been taking the land for years and years and years, and
don't know how to stop, and some people are tired of it, and some people are standing up, and they're being shot and put in prison, and, well, you know, the Bundy deal, you know, over, you know, old ranch land there. I mean, it's not like that's really prime property, you know?
Well, I think they're just trying to goad people into a revolution, it seems like. They're really pushing to get people to revolt.
Yeah,
you know?
I was, you know, and I've been in law enforcement all my life, but, you know, I told some people that were holed up somewhere that I would just let you walk out if you wanted to, you know, I'd just let them walk out, you know, if that's what I told them, I'd let them do. However,
mm-hmm.
It's interesting that they told them that, and then they put up checkpoints all around them where you have to go through the so almost military checkpoint to walk out. Now, that's not quite... You know,
so they arrest them when they leave. Yeah.
Well, do you remember, Stewart? Do you remember way back when the courts finally ruled that law enforcement officers could lie to the people, and it was awful?
Yeah.
Well, it's not a joke anymore. I mean, you know, back when I was in there and it was protect and serve. You know, we didn't lie. We didn't go to court and lie. Now the law has been interpreted to the point by the courts that a law enforcement officer can go to court and lie, and it's okay. You know, and
yeah, which is a total perversion of raising your hand and swearing you're going to tell the truth.
Well, it's almost like the Supreme Court telling God how to run his world.
Well, they seem to be thinking they can do that. I got a hunch that they're going to be in for a big, big surprise one of these days. And I'm not so sure that surprise isn't very far off.
I'll tell you what. Yeah, that was an interesting. You know, we had this recent storm called Jonas. You know, in the Northeast.
Yes.
And the funny thing was that, you know, Jonas means a gift from God. And I took it as one more warning, and actually there's two things working right now that really this is really an earthly way to put it, but something that gets under God's skin, so to speak, if he had skin, which you don't. But
yep,
there's two things that's going on in the world right now that there's real trouble, and Bill Koenig is really one. He's got Koenig International News, you know, that he really, really keeps up with a lot of the Israel stuff and what's going on in Israel. And he wrote the book Eye to Eye. And, you know, he says, you know, a lot of what we're doing to Israel and against Israel now, that God's not winking at it. You know, he's not winking. He's not looking the other way. You know, he sees clearly, and there'd be a price to be paid. Well, the same thing is that I say is for abortion, you know.
Well, I don't see.
It seems, yeah, we've had so many warnings about mass abortion. What it is, it's abortion on demand. People can call it anything. They can call it women's health all they want to, but everybody knows what it is. Everybody knows. And, you know, this is what we don't understand, Stewart, about, and I may be like you and everybody be mad at me, too, for saying this, but... the interesting thing is the fact that there's a lot of warnings been coming down to old America for a number of years over this abortion issue. And now, of course, we've got we've got the gay marriages, we've got, same-sex marriages,
Well, we've opened the door.
Yeah, yep. We've opened the door that it's really, really got bad. And, I just, you know, I have to agree with, like, Koenig says, Jonas was another warning. How many warnings do we have before no more warnings? And
well,
I'm surprised.
Somebody put on a they took the satellite picture of Jonas, and it's shaped like a whale, and the mouth was open right around Washington, D.C. I don't know if you saw that or not.
No, I didn't see that. That's
right. He traced it out, and it looks just like a huge whale. And the mouth was open right around Washington. And, of course, that would definitely then be a warning that, you know, you've got a little time here to repent. But we know from prophecy she will not repent.
Well,
I remember the vision
I
had where I was taken to Washington and I was shown. And the Lord said that it's over.
Well, this is what concerns me, Stewart, is, you know, I know, you know, you and I both, we look out the window, we raise the window and look out, we don't see any repentance. Where is the repentance?
None.
It's not even in the church, you know?
Yeah,
I know. And so when we do that and we understand that there's no repentance, and it's so shocking that everybody's, I guess, putting their money on this new election. And this, Franklin Graham came out with something a couple of days ago. Darnett brought it up yesterday when we were talking. Franklin Graham told everybody, he said, I cannot imagine that people that would know God would really think that another election is going to save them.
They do, though.
I know they do. I know.
You know.
I know. And I used to almost cry tears over it. Now I just have to laugh because it's gone on so long, you know?
Well, that's it. And you know, I laugh at a lot of this stuff because if you don't laugh, you'd cry.
Oh, my, yes.
I mean, when you look out at what's actually happening, we're watching an entire nation go under a total dictator, a brutality, like unlike anything probably we've ever seen, once they come into power, and yet the American people are, you know, stuffing their brats in their face, drinking their beer, watching their programs on TV, totally brainwashed as far as I can see. And I don't see any repentance. I don't even think they know what the word means.
I think that's, it's almost like what I'll call intercession. It's a lost art. It's something like Adam might have had at one time, and people later on down the road from Adam lost it. That glow. It's almost all the things that really, the worship of the Lord, you know, you're talking about spiritual warfare, all these things, those are all lost tools almost. Matter of fact, I was talking to Augusto Perez the other day, and he said things had gotten so bad everywhere that he said, we need greater weapons. We need the Lord to give us some greater weapons because we just almost can't fend off this evil and this darkness. It's beginning to cover the whole world. It's not even America, Stewart. It's covering the whole world now.
Yeah, gross spiritual darkness covereth the people.
That's right.
And they don't understand it because they're not, I don't know whether they've, well, I think the Native Americans really said it best, that we have cut off the spiritual. That's what happens when you get materialistic.
That's right.
The spiritual aspect of ourselves slowly just dies off. It goes away.
You know, I was reading. I wanted to bring this up before I forgot it because I wanted to say it, and I just now crossed my mind again. I was reading your copy of the book, Babylon Down, which,
yes,
by the way, is really, really good. And I was reading in there about how the rich men, you know, and I'm only like 50 pages into it, so I haven't read the whole thing, so I can't really comment on all of it. But I was reading especially the area there in the first section of it, how that the rich men actually bring on what you would call these Holocausts. In other words, they get rid of the people that love the Lord. The people that want to live for the Lord and live to the, you know, according to the book, the real book, the Bible, they get rid of them en masse. And I was reading that, and you are so right. And then, you know, what came to mind, and I'm going to ask you your opinion on this, because you remember that, you know, we had, of course, the, you know, the Holocaust, especially they, you know, blamed Hitler for it, basically, but the Holocaust, you know, of the Jews. We had such a horrible Holocaust in America of the Native Americans, you know, when all of this started, and they came and took everything they had. They destroyed their way of life. They tortured them. They killed all they could kill. They put them on death marches. I mean, this was people that came into America that did this. And so, you know, in the Nazi one, you know, you're in Germany, you're sowing seeds when you do that. The Bible says, you know, what you sow, you'll reap.
Yes,
well,
you do.
You know, well, we saw that. We saw the Native Americans in America. You know, we saw the, you remember Turkey was the one that brought the great Holocaust against the,
Armenians?
Armenians, absolutely, absolutely. The Armenians, matter of fact, that's why some of the Armenians fled. The Lord had warned them to flee Armenia to America, to the west coast of America, you know, at that time.
Didn't you look into a letter?
No, but let me ask you this question, though.
Yeah.
If you've ever thought about it. All of a sudden, you know, a lot of times when you sow something, you'll also reap it. And a lot of times, biblically, it's your sons and daughters that reap it, not necessarily you that sowed it, you know, the generation that sowed it, but down the generation, you know.
Yes.
Like a curse that goes through the generations. And I really often wondered, there's been such a worldwide movement of this ISIS and this terrorist, you know, the terrorist format over the whole planet. But
mm-hmm.
This is what's interesting, Stewart. The ones that are impacted so much have been like, where is this terror building and hitting right now? It's in Germany. It's in Europe, where the Holocaust occurred, those nations where the Holocaust occurred
with the
Jews. And you're seeing it in America that's building and happening now. There's an influx of all of this terrorism. And this is what's interesting, Stewart. Erdogan in Turkey, you know, I'll mention him because this is what's so strange. You know, Russia right now is right on the border of Turkey, and Turkey's got really major problems with Russia right now. And remember, Turkey was the ones that caused the Holocaust, and they even deny it today, and Obama won't even speak of it, but they had the Holocaust of the Armenians. Now, Russia is close to invading or attacking Turkey, you know, and you're seeing something all around the world. It's almost like payback, you know?
I agree 100%. I think what's happening here in America is going to be payback.
Let me mention this real quick or I'll forget it. I'm getting older. But Erdogan, who is he's the president of Turkey. He told Obama the other day, and I posted that today on my website. He told Obama, he said, there is no radical Islam. There is no moderate Islam. Islam is just Islam.
Well,
it is true.
And I think people, you know, we are being, there's that concept known as Chislam. But really what is going on is you cannot criticize Islam over here in America anymore, or you get into a lot of trouble. And Obama, they can say what they want. Oh, he's a Christian. He's this, he's that. No, he isn't. I'm not sure what he is, but I do know one thing. He favors and is even said so right out loud. When push comes to shove, I'm going to back the Islamics.
Yeah.
Well, okay, what's he doing? I mean, we created ISIL. We created ISIS. Those are CIA operations.
That's right.
And when you get into Habakkuk and you read what we did and how we go into these nations and we try to topple them and all of that, we're getting payback. You can't do that sort of thing. You have to what goes around comes around is the secular version of do unto others what you would have them do unto you. You know, the golden rule that we forget as a nation, we have totally forgotten it. And it's going to get extremely interesting in the political field, and I agree with you 100%. The people really do believe, well, okay, we've had the Democrats in power, and that didn't work. So now let's put in the Republicans, and that didn't work. So now let's put in another Democrat or whatever, and we're on the way to the New World Order, irrespective of who we put in there. You would think the people would figure out it doesn't matter who we vote for. The rich men run it all.
Yeah, isn't it true that there is a saying or a report that I've heard said many times, and it's almost like the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expect a different ending.
Yeah, exactly. That is kind of, I think that's where we're at, and I'm not sure that that's ever going to get solved. I've often wondered what has happened to the people in the United States. Is there a line drawn anywhere in the sand? They can come steal the kids through Child Protection Services.
They've
you don't know who
years.
Your accuser
yeah.
is.
There's,
and
there,
they
you know,
don't say anything
ago,
about it.
That's right. Years ago, you know the old folks. You know, they wouldn't
yes.
put up with what's going on in Washington 5 minutes. Not even 5 minutes.
I know.
And
there'd
now,
be a lot of them
now,
hanging
in
the streets.
There's, you know, Art Bell was right. The American people are so pitiful. I'll make people mad at me again. But he said, you know, the American people are so pitiful, as he would put it, they're just too lazy to even get up and change the channel when they don't like what they're watching.
I know. When he said that, you know, you almost want to fall off the chair laughing, but it's so sad. Because they won't. And I don't, you know, he was absolutely right. And we are at that stage now where I don't think there's anything going on that the American people won't put up with. Let's take a look at that survey that Alex Jones did. And he had a professional survey, paid for professionals to do it. Would you subject yourself to a cavity search? I want the women to think about this, and the men, to fly on an airplane. Would you subject yourself to a cavity search so you could fly from A to B? 33 or 34% of them said they would. Can you imagine that?
They want to fly real bad, don't they?
I guess. I mean, I just about dropped my teeth when he came out with that poll. But that's just one thing. Then you got, like we were talking about, Child Protection Services. Well, then we had the Supreme Court rule on Roe versus Wade, and they ruled Jesus Christ out of the classrooms.
That's right.
And nobody
really,
has said
yeah.
they don't say anything.
And now in America, Stuart, Jesus Christ is a great enemy, a great enemy.
I know. When I was on Randy Yarborough's show the other day, I said, you know, Jesus Christ was the greatest friend that planet Earth ever had.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, they nailed him up. They just
that's
nailed
right.
him up. They didn't want a friend, I guess. Well, that's payback too, isn't it? I mean, if you get the blessings of Deuteronomy, which the United States of America actually did have
that's
all
true.
The blessings outlined in Deuteronomy chapter 28, now we have inherited all the curses of Deuteronomy chapter 28. The biggest curse of all, of course, is the rise up of the rich men of the earth. I posted
mm-hmm.
some stuff on YouTube about the rich men of the earth. I did a kind of a background check on them, and I got into some of their documents and how they would rise up and take control over the entire planet. Well, they've done it.
They have. And you know what? This is really interesting, Stuart. You remember we used to talk about Jeremiah 50 and 51. And,
yes.
And one of the things that I really have to say now is probably very, very crucial. When Babylon goes down, the only people that fight are the rulers. It appears in Scripture.
Yes. They're trying to stir up a revolution, but the Bible doesn't talk about, and I'm not saying a revolution won't occur, but it does talk about the rulers fighting the rulers. And I've often wondered.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
That's okay. I was just going to say that I remember the old Norwegian seer.
Yes.
Jonathan, I can't remember his last name this minute, but anyway, you know, he actually had said the Lord had came to him and talked to him about America. Of course, he didn't live in America, so he didn't remember a lot of it. But the Lord did tell him, he said, this is according to him, he said that that America was going to have another civil war.
and it would divide up in like three different small states. In other words, America would break up from what it was. And, you know, it would take the rulers to do that. I mean, and you know, we're having talk. You know, I'm not seeing the people objecting really to anything. You don't even hear the people. What people? They don't even call in anymore. I don't even get comments hardly anymore, Stewart, on anything.
I don't either. I don't
it's
either.
Like
well, I get comments.
All Americans, yeah. unless I'm on maybe Handy's radio show or somebody else's, nobody's listening. You know, you and I, we don't have many that care to listen to what we say, but we try to tell the truth. But anyway,
well, that's all you can do.
Yeah, but I do believe though that what we're seeing now, the Republicans and Democrats. Matter of fact, the Republicans, certain ones are even fighting the other Republicans. And it's ruler against ruler. That's what we're seeing. And we're not seeing the people fighting. I think the rulers, if there is a civil war, this is just Larry Taylor's opinion, the rulers will start the civil war and promote it, you know, and the battles will go on. And we'll never, you know, this is one thing that I'm really sure of, Stewart, is that America will never see it return to what it was. What we have seen and enjoyed when you and I were kids and growing up and going to school and then having our lifetime, basically, we'll never see it again, and none of our children ever will, because of who's there now.
Well, wasn't there a Russian scientist who issued a report about the breakup of the United States? He issued that maybe 2-3 years ago, and he said the same thing.
You mean a physical breakup?
Yes.
A physical breakup? Yeah.
Kind of a war, and there would be a breakup of the United States would fracture, I guess, so to speak, politically. And certain, there would be four, maybe five different regions.
It seems like an old Soviet or Russian general was maybe one of the ones that talked about that some. I can't remember exactly.
I don't remember exactly who he was, but he even drew a map out, I think, if I recall right. And we are very, very close to that, I think, because the people really, I think they're so frustrated they just don't know what to do, so they don't do anything.
That's true.
You know,
well, one thing about it, have you ever, you know, when you've got a Russian river going by you and you throw a leaf out on it, that leaf just flies on down the river, not knowing how to get out, not knowing where it's going. We're like that. The people in America are just like that. We're rolling on, and we don't know where it stops it don't stop, so we can get off. We're in this ride to the end, I guess.
Well, you know, that brings up a very interesting thing, because people have said, and I hear this frequently, it seems like time is speeding up.
You know, I've heard that from a number of people.
Do you suppose that is what the Lord is talking about? We were talking about how the earth could go down to 8 hours, but what if time itself sped up?
Well, here's something that's interesting. To go along with what you're saying. Go ahead.
Would we recognize it?
I don't think that we would, and the reason I say that is, you know well as I do that they and Stan Dale talked to me about some of this, about some time testing that they had done, and even the astronauts that actually go out in space, when they come back from space, they're not as old as everybody else is, not really, and you know, time is a very interesting thing, because, and it seems like gravity has something to do with that, because when they're off planet, they don't age like they do on the planet. It's very weird how this works. And Stan even saw some people that, you know, went into what they were doing time experiments, and they would go in for a few minutes and then come out with facial hair that had grown in just a few minutes. And he said it's really odd. And he said there's a lot about time we don't understand, and that a lot of the projects that have been working with it for many years are way ahead of where we think they are. And, you know, I know you brought up a real interesting thing in a recent show, and I'll just mention it because I know we've only got just a few minutes left. But you talked about, you thought that in the end time that that somebody would use time to try to change something. And this go, you know, we can talk about this because of CERN and the experiments and all of that, but
yes,
there is some time stuff going on, and I've often wondered if something happened to time or happened in time to change something possibly, would we even know it or be clueless? And I really think we would be clueless, actually.
That's what I was wondering, because people say, well, I used to be able to do this, you know, in 30 minutes. Takes me 2 hours.
Oh, and at least,
So then you just say, well, it's because you're getting older, you know. You're just slowing down. You don't realize it. But this is coming even from people that are young, that the day just goes by. And
what's interesting, too, I don't know if you've noticed it. You know, I've watched the sun lately. I watch it because there's been a lot of activity on the sun lately with magnetic strips, and I keep up with all that stuff. But
yes,
the sun lately, have you noticed how quick it crosses the sky? Really, really fast.
Well, is that us, or is that, you know, is it because we're getting old and senile, or I don't know. I mean, if that could be what that's about, then it could be that he speeds time up. And so, you know, if you took that into account, your so-called 7 years that we look at would not be 7 years. You'd have to reduce it by a third. Let's say if we started all this, we don't know when it starts. But it's just kind of an interesting concept, and that brings us to CERN. What's really going on at CERN? Have you heard any more?
Yeah, they're doing some stuff over there that they're going beyond what they've ever done, but has ever been done with colliders. And you'll remember, I know you will, when we began to watch CERN and some of the activity going on, and then remember the big mishap that they had in CERN and the
yes,
face appeared on the computers. Remember, I got the German newspaper from Klaus Dohna in Austria that
yes,
talked about this. And remember, right after that, now this is what's really odd to me. You know, that CERN is a worldwide deal. I mean, that's all the, you know, most of the countries are represented in CERN, actually. It's in Geneva. And remember, they came out and said that because of, and they used the term Al-Qaeda then, that they were going to go into a secrecy, kind of like national security, but this is CERN security. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Where you really don't get much information anymore like we did before then. Before then, they talked all the time about everything they've done. But, you know, since then, they've done some strides in dark matter. They've done some, you know, movement in different things. But there's been a lot of warnings coming out lately of different physicists that they're operating and trying to open the portals, wormholes, really into a parallel universe, and they're claiming now they've done that to a degree, but they're wanting to get deeper into the parallel universe, so to speak, and that's the terminology they're using, not me. And so, you know, and what makes it so strange is an old Nostradamus, and I'm not telling everybody to believe Nostradamus, but there is an old Nostradamus quatrain that deals with, I've read it a couple of times, it deals with something that happens in Geneva where the dead lay as far as you can see, something blowed up or something exploded or something and dead are everywhere. It's really a strange quatrain. It said that everybody will flee Geneva, and now that's never happened. So, and I wonder, CERN related? I mean, I don't know.
Well, the temperatures.
We got a lot of things to keep our eyes on, you know?
Yeah, the temperatures inside those colliders is hotter than the sun.
Absolutely.
So if something went wrong, I mean, that could melt almost instantly. In fact, there was an English program, I don't know what it was, 5 ways the world could end, and they did have a collider in there. And it formed a black hole, and the black hole ate everybody up. So, you know, but it was quite realistic how they actually portrayed it.
Well, you
and,
know,
you
there,
know.
There is, you know, there is even Stephen Hawkins.
Yes.
you know, the guy that the physicist, he's really incredibly smart. He's been warning about it too. That he said what they're dealing with in physics, he said, is disaster, and that's what he's been warning. Of course, nobody listening, but I'm watching some of the articles he's been writing and putting out, and he has been warning about trying to open these wormholes and portals and you know, moving that type of activity.
Well, isn't he also the one who warned that sending these probes out there to aliens might not be such a smart concept?
That's what he said.
Because the aliens might be so far advanced that they would view us as, you know, useless eaters, kind of like the rich men view us as it is.
Reminds me of the old Twilight Zone, black and white, that time, To Serve Man.
Yes, the cookbook. I remember that was a classic. But
that shows how old you and I are.
I guess it does, but you know, it's this whole thing is a deception.
It is.
And you know, the Lord said, "Don't let people deceive you." That deception is going to be the order of the day as we approach the end. And you can't get a straight answer, what do they say, never a straight answer out of NASA. Every time Obama moves his lips, he's probably not telling you the truth, like in the State of the Union where the economy is just great. you know, people are being laid off left and right all over the country. Maybe we should talk about that a little bit. I was reading some articles where there are shortages now starting to show up in stores.
A lot of places. And matter of fact, I don't know if you've seen the most recent. They're closing lots of Walmart stores now, lots of them across the country.
I'm wondering if that doesn't have to do with possibly Jade Helm and the coming Roundup.
There's a lot of people that thinks that Jade Helm is part of a bigger picture. It's just a part of something that's coming, and they know it, and they're preparing using Jade Helm to do that, that it's not ultimately only to gather people, but it goes far beyond that into where we're going as far as not only the nation but the planet.
Yeah, I've heard that Jade Helm is directly connected to the destroyer, the inbound destroyer, and they know that. And so I don't know, but then you got the Baltic Dry Index, where it tracks shipping. Most of the shipping is already. Then you've got layoffs all over the United States. The truckers are claiming those shipments are slowing down, and that the railroad traffic is slowing down.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say that, you know, through MENA runs a major railroad through Heavener and then MENA, hauling lots of coal and hauling lots of really everything. And a matter of fact, I've seen some of those strange-looking rail cars, you know, that two-tier that might carry more than just items. Anyway, you're seeing less and less. Those trains are smaller and shorter now. There's a slowdown of some kind.
We've got a huge line of those kind of cars parked right here by Menominee.
Huh.
And it makes you wonder what's going on. But, you know, I mean, the economy's great because Obama says it's great. And he wouldn't. Would he lie to us, do you think?
Well, you know, those that I listen to quite often that really talk about, and everybody seems to watch the markets, that's their scale. You know, it's kind of like watching a thermometer. They're watching the wrong one, but the markets are propped up. That's what they're seeing is not real. And really, if people only knew, Stewart, it's already fallen. You know, Babylon basically has already collapsed. But they're just holding it up a little longer till they get they're having a little trouble implementing their plan.
Well, I was reading one of the rich guy, but he's an economist, and he said he thinks it may rally one more time to just suck everybody in, and then boom, the final collapse comes.
You know, I've heard a lot of rumors, and there is some people talking about really, really major stuff about March or April, maybe, or maybe June. So, you know, it's not long off. We're probably on borrowed time anyway, however. But I'm surprised the Lord has really put all this off as long as he had. But I appreciate him doing that. You know, we're still surviving, Stewart, even hard places up here.
Well, I do remember, I think it was a comment you made, that if you and I were in control of this, the delete button would have been hit some time ago.
Well, that's probably true.
So, yeah, we should be thankful. And, you know, I'm telling everybody that's listening, you know, be thankful for every normal day you have from now on. Because sooner or later, I mean, like the rich guys can pull the derivative plug anytime they want, and you can wake up tomorrow morning and the whole thing is collapsed. I don't think that's going to happen just yet, but like you say, we are on the verge. We're right there. You know, can you tell us one more time how to get a hold of your website so make sure people get it?
Sure. The easiest way is to just go to the link. LarryWTaylor.org. That's LarryWTaylor.org. And if you can go there, you can see ways to contact me. And you can also read all the data. And it's a full-time job just trying to keep up with the news. And I know you know that, Stewart, because you do a good job of it, too.
It's hard. And it does take a lot of time. And, you know, people need to support those that are doing it. And that support is waning as well. I know times are tough out there for people, but it's getting rough. So I don't know what you can say to people about it. You know, I mean, it's just the way it is.
Well, I know one thing, Stewart. You know, there's a lot. You know, they're always talking about we need the rich people in America to give a little bit more money to taxes. You know what, Stewart, I'm surprised some of the rich people hadn't decided you and I were worthy of something and sent us a little help, but they don't. They don't.
No, they don't. I can't imagine why either. I just can't imagine why they don't. But I guess that's the way it is. So anyway, I don't know, do they warn us now through this that we're coming at the end? I know I set it up for 2 hours. So hopefully we got a minute left. What do you think about this Zika virus?
There's a lot of rumors. Here again, there are some rumors that this is a product and so that's been put out, and, you know, kind of like the Lyme disease. So we don't know. I mean, we really don't. However, they are pushing it forward and calling it they're even calling it an America pandemic. When really there's not that many sick, but you know they're doing some things with health in America.
Well, aren't they like California now? They've passed these forced vaccination laws, where you know personal conscience, religious reasons, you don't count anymore. Line up, get your shot. And I'm wondering if it's tied to this Zika or whatever you call it, new pandemic. Possibly.
Well, it possibly could be because you remember the recent flus and things that they've tried to incorporate hasn't really worked out for them that well.
Yeah. I guess we're done. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. Yeah, I think we're out now.
Okay.
I didn't hear any warnings.
Me, Stewart.
Yeah, well, thanks for coming on. We'll have to do this again.
We'll do it. Thanks a lot, Stewart.
Yeah, okay.
Bye-bye.